Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Almost exactly 43 years ago, two astronauts had just left the surface of the moon and were preparing to leave lunar orbit with command module pilot Alfred Worden. David Scott and James Irwin landed on July 30th, 1971, and had rocketed back off the moon's surface on August 2nd. Although we cannot actually see the landing site from Earth, we can find its general location. On Monday or Tuesday, look for Mare Imbrium, which will be the large, dark-floored region along the terminator, or shadowed side of the moon, in the northern hemisphere. Note the long mountain range of Montes Apenninus along the southeastern side of Mare Imbrium. Most obvious on Monday is 58 kilometers across Eratosthenes. One feature to look for on Monday is that of the very low-walled ring depression of Stadius nearby. At 65 kilometers diameter, it's slightly larger than Eratosthenes. But the very low walls mean a striking difference in how they look. At a mere 650 meters of height, a low angle of the sun helps us to see the smaller walls of Stadius on Monday. Conversely, Eratosthenes is 5.5 times deeper, making for far longer shadows due to the increased depth. Compare and contrast these two on Monday. Stadius is largely lost to an elevated sun angle by Tuesday. Meandering back up and along the mountain range, look for the deep shadow created by Mons Hadley. It is located on the northern end of the mountains, not far from the crater Autolycus. The Montes Apenninus range rises up to 5,000 meters. It's about 3 miles high. They can be quite steep on the Mare Imbrium side, too, about 30 degrees. And so by Tuesday, several of the larger mountains will still display shadows, such as Mons Bradley, Huygens, and Ampere. But near the foot of Mons Hadley was the destination of the astronauts who visited the moon 43 years ago. And it was one of the most geologically diverse ones of the Apollo missions, too. On their second day there, the astronauts collected the so-called Genesis Rock, a very old anorthosite, which was thought to be a piece of the moon's primordial crust, but was later determined to be a younger 4.1 billion years old sample from the early solar system. For other lunar features to see this week, visit eyesonthesky.com. And now this week's dark sky fact. Think the full moon is bright? Most streetlights are 30 to 100 times brighter than the full moon, which can disrupt your ability to sleep well with windows open, according to several studies looking at light levels and how they affect melatonin. If you have lights that disrupt your sleep, contact your local authorities, explain the issue, and work to get lights shielded or changed. Together, we can reduce light pollution. Also on Monday, the moon forms a slightly bent line with Saturn and Mars. The moon will then advance towards the east each night through the region we explored last week in Sagittarius with Messier 8 and Messier 22 on the 6th and 7th. Though you may wish to wait another 4 or 5 days to return to those deep sky objects due to the overwhelming glow of the moon's light. As Luna makes its way into Capricornus and then Aquarius by the weekend, let's spin even more this direction towards the northeastern sky. Locate Perseus rising here. The second brightest star in this shape is Beta Persei, also known as Algol, or the Demon Star. It is so called likely due to its well-known eclipsing variable nature, a winking star, if you will, and you can watch this occur on early Wednesday morning, or perhaps part of very late Tuesday night into Wednesday. Algol will be at its minimum magnitude at 4:30 UTC, which is 12:30 Eastern, 11:30 Central Daylight Time. Algol's brightness will then increase from a minimum of 3.4 back to 2.1 magnitude over about 5 hours. See eyesonthesky.com for more information on this star. And keep an eye out on this area too. The Perseid meteor shower peaks next week. And despite the interference of the full moon, we can trace the trails of these often bright meteors back to the constellation of Perseus. More on that phenomenon next week, but be on the lookout. Random Perseids arrive as early as July 17th. Did you like this video? Subscribe on YouTube and please consider sharing with others on social media sites so we can continue educating about light pollution. Thanks for watching. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.